Good morning and welcome to Fairlawn Avenue United Church on this third Sunday in Advent. It's good to have you here. Joining together in this journey to hope, this journey of transformation. Music is such an evocative part and poignant part of the Advent and Christmas seasons. And so you really should always scroll down below this video for a link to the music that accompanies, that Eleanor Daley has put together for us. Your worship today, especially as we work our way towards Christmas, will not be complete until that's a part of it too. Here are some words of prayer to ease us into worship this day. God of life, we need light. The days are so short. The chill in the air catches our breath. The ground is barren and the landscape bleak. We need light, a star to follow, stories bearing witness to our yearning, a light that shines in our darkness, that the darkness did not, does not, will not, and cannot overcome. Loving God, we open ourselves to you, trusting that you created us for joy-filled hearts and lives. Show us the creative power of love. Teach us the peace that comes from justice. Fill us with the kind of joy that cannot be contained. Be the light for our darkness. Amen. To light our third Advent candle, the candle of joy, we're joined by the Kara Nicholas family.
This Advent, through experiences of loss, through a continuing sense of risk from the continued spread of the coronavirus, we seek out experiences of joy, recognizing that joy can come upon us even through tears. We anticipate the transforming arrival of joy.
In this season of expectant waiting, we seek out moments of joy, and our feet begin to move and dance.
Into our dance come so many partners, the old and the newly born, the wounded and weary.
All genders and expressions, cultures and languages, dancing to the rhythm and pattern of joy in life.
Rooted in joy, embracing each person as worthy, embracing each soul as loved by God.
Joy flames into a grateful celebration of diversity and abundance.
Our reader this morning is Barb Warner.
Good morning. In the Gospel of John, while the figure who we know as John the Baptist does baptize a few people, he is never given that name. In this gospel, John is primarily the witness to the one who is to come, who is Jesus. As a result, when John is confronted by religious leaders and asked to identify himself, he does so by listing who he is not. He is not the Messiah. He is not Elijah. He is not the prophet. He is a voice, a witness, testifying about the light of God. The words immediately before our text are about this light. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not overcome it. In our day, when light is taken for granted, it is hard for us to appreciate the power of this image. In the dead of winter, in the midst of the shortest days of the year, festivals of light were essential. John's words that the light of the world is shining when darkness should prevail are liberating. In the midst of the darkness we experience in the world, now light will shine. Our reading is from John 1, verses 6 to 8 and 19 to 28. A man named John was sent from God. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him, everyone would believe in the light. He himself wasn't the light, but his mission was to testify concerning the light. This is John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him, "Who are you?" John confessed. He didn't deny, but confessed, "I'm not the Christ." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" John said, "I'm not." "Are you the prophet?" John answered, "No." They asked, "Who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied, "I am a voice crying out in the wilderness, 'Make the Lord's path straight,' just as the prophet Isaiah said." Those sent by the Pharisees asked, "Why do you baptize if you aren't the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered, "I baptize with water. Someone greater stands among you whom you don't recognize. He comes after me, but I'm not worthy to untie his sandal straps." This encounter took place across the Jordan in Bethany, where John was baptizing. In this reading, we hear God's voice. God is still speaking. Thanks be to God.
This week, a few of us gathered for midweek prayer, as we do. We aren't many, for the most part. But we talk about how we're doing and how things are going with those we love. And it's become an important time of sharing. Each week we begin with the reading of the text that I am reflecting on each week for our Sunday worship. And we have such interesting conversations, which often range far and wide beyond, far beyond the text. So this week, we read the story from John, and we ended up sharing stories of birth, such sacred moments as women and men around the circle shared memory and experience of the births that we have been a part of. But how did we get to birth stories from this reading about John in the wilderness? I realized that it had something to do with joy. You see, last Sunday, we had Elizabeth, John's mother, pregnant and caring for her much younger cousin, Mary, also pregnant with life. And now, in our reading today, we have an adult John, Elizabeth's child, a prophet who's uncomfortable with that role, denying it, in fact, but a witness nonetheless to what God is up to in the world. John is so awake and paying attention. He senses that God is about to do something remarkable that tells us something new about God. Something new that will take our relationship with God so much deeper and make our experience of God a reflection of a vulnerable love that can transform the world. John begins his ministry from a place of humility. He doesn't claim any special identity or prophetic legacy. He simply asks the people who gather around him to prepare themselves for what God is up to in the world, for one who is coming. Watch, he says. Be prepared for something amazing when you least expect it, and yet also are most yearning for it. John may define himself in the story by what he is not, but he has remarkable gifts and abilities. He has tremendous integrity and strength. Crowds of people gather. They gather around him. They're amazed by him. It makes the religious leaders and those in power nervous, in fact. But popularity holds no attraction for John, nor does power. His place is in the wilderness, far from the centers of power and prestige in Jerusalem. But in that wilderness place, there's such joy, because John has a clear sense that God is up to something in the world. And as harsh as we may imagine John to be, this rigid prophetic figure of camel hair and locusts, there is this joy about him. Maybe joy surprises us too, on occasion when we figure out how to forge paths in the COVID wilderness. When we make a way in difficult places for something larger than ourselves. When we discover God present in stories of birth that catch us off guard and unawares. Moments when we simply feel so incredibly loved and deeply known. On this third Sunday in Advent, joy is in the air. We might even dare to proclaim that despite appearances to the contrary, joy and good news is coming. The voices of coming good news are changing our lives. In the midst of the trauma of pandemic, we live in hope for a vaccine. But we need greater hope beyond this pandemic. There remains so much fear and uncertainty. And at Christmas, we need not just birth, but maybe also resurrection. Life beyond death. We need a little bit of Easter already. We need a powerful sense of joy that God's world is being transformed by God's impossible possibilities, as Mary said, that God's way is emerging in a troubled world. that God's Spirit is spilling out on us with a kind of crazy abundance, and that the vulnerable, the outcast, and the least will experience healing. It may feel that we are a voice crying out in the wilderness, but there is light for our darkness. This year, this Christmas, may we be surprised by a joy that is beyond our planning and our efforts and our best intentions, but that comes to us like a birth, catching us off guard despite all our well-laid plans. God, here in our midst, joy. John the Baptist is anything but mainstream. It is maybe his eccentricity that makes his brand so compelling. His simplicity and his deep connection to his followers. His messaging is clear and consistent. He stays in his lane, as people might say today. He speaks with authority and with authenticity. His commitment is its own brand, in a way, occupying that sweet spot where purpose meets passion. He's tapped into his own potential, his own commitment. He knows his why. He knows his who. John the Baptist is not an easy person. And yet he's reaching deep within himself in the story of the people who are around him to give voice to a joyful kind of hope. The Ghanaian people, the people from Ghana in Africa, call it Sankofa. The Sankofa is a metaphorical symbol used by the Akan people of Ghana, a bird with its head turned backwards, taking an egg from off its own back. It expresses the importance of reaching back to knowledge that is gained in the past and bringing it into the present in order to make progress. This is how we prepare the way. We tell the stories like John crying out in the wilderness, preparing a way that brings joyful hope, not just because of the discovery of a vaccine, although that too is hopeful, but because even in dark days, we find God bringing light and life and joy that helps us find a way together. And we are so grateful that we are doing that together as a community of faith. Amen. And now Julia Seager-Sott is joining us with the introduction to Britain's Ceremony of Carols. As always, please let us know if you or someone that you are aware of needs someone to give them a call or to check in, just to help out, to provide assistance. An email to me or to the church office, or a call to someone who can do that for you, will work well to ensure that someone gets back to you promptly. We care about how we're doing with each other, and that's important. And now let us take a moment to gather our thoughts and our hearts and our spirits in prayer. Let us pray. God of joy, through your love for us, joy emerges. You playfully create a universe full of mystery and wonder. Even the smallest molecules dance and vibrate with life. You give us the gift of relationship, people to discover the world with, friends to laugh with, families to multiply our joy. You delight in laughter and in play and in the goodness of life. You have the power to take what is sad and mournful and use it for good. We're grateful for that joy that you bring into our lives through this Fairlawn church community and through the love of family and friends. We thank you for the joy of music, especially at Christmas, which lightens our souls and prepares our hearts for your coming among us again. Even as we thank you for all the joy that we experience as we work and play with Christmas carols on our lips, we recognize that joy is difficult for many of us at this time of year. We pray for those who are sick in spirit, mind, or body, those who are in hospital. We pray for those who are worried about loved ones or about medical test results or just about the future. We pray for those who are lonely or who are mourning. In our prayers, in our spiritual practice, in our reflecting, guide us to align ourselves with your vision for the world that you so love. A vision of hope, a vision of peace and of joy. Remind us that we are your hands and your feet and your voice in the world. Remind us of the words of the angel who brought tidings of great joy to all humanity, that we may use the power of words and of presence to bring joy to others. Open us to notice and attend to the opportunities to offer friendship and comfort to those around us. Give us faith that indeed your vision for a renewed creation is near to us and that we are part of its unveiling. From deep inside, we bring to you, listening God, our prayers, with words or without, the prayers of our hearts. Draw near to us in our grief, in our confusion, in our struggles, in our gratitude, in our joy and moments of renewal, that we may look up and discover you ever in our midst. We pray for members of this congregation who are awaiting tests, who are anticipating surgery, who are worried about family members, dealing with financial or emotional stress. We think of people whom we know, and we pray for them in our hearts. God of love, God of light, shine through our darkness and bring us hope. Open our hearts for this journey of life that we are on together. Open our eyes for your vision of justice and open our spirits for the peace which you bring. We pray as followers of Jesus with words that he gave to his friends. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Tonight, our service of lessons and carols will, I hope, bring some joy to you and to yours. The familiar readings and music will hopefully bring life to your Christmas. The link is with the link for this service. And so please join us and share it with family and friends who might appreciate this Fairlawn tradition. After the service today, our coffee chat will gather around the virtual coffee pot online using Zoom. The details for connecting are in greetings and were included in the notice that you received this morning for this worship service. And now let us bless one another. In this season of Advent and approaching Christmas, let us bless one another. In the promise which is everywhere about us, hold us, God. In the longing for a new world and a new living, cradle us, God. In the need to see Advent's joy in our world, guide us, O God. In the silence of memories that grieve us, comfort us, O God. In the hunger for justice that aches within us, fill us, O God. In the yearning for love in each of our days, reassure us, O God, and fill us with your Spirit and with your peace. Go in peace. Amen.